So in one corner, we have Laurence Tubiana. Yes, that's exactly right. You could also be in the middle. Oh, that's very cozy. That's nice. Okay, great. So in this corner, we have Laurence Tubiana. She is CEO of the European Climate Foundation, which is a relatively new job, so congratulations on that. Amongst her old jobs was the post as France's special representative for the 2015 Paris Climate Conference, where she helped build those crucial coalitions that got France to yes, as we say. You were very much part of the getting to yes process. She teaches at the Sciences Po in Paris, and she was founder and director of the Institute for Sustainable Development and International Relations. It's a great honor to have you with us, Laurence Tubiana. And, yeah, okay, great. And in the other corner, Dr. Kurt Bock is chair of the Energy, Climate, and Resource Efficiency Task Force of the B20, and that is the network of businesses, of companies, that essentially works together with the G20. And he is also chairman of the board of executive directors of the global chemicals giant BASF, and he was formerly CFO and also served as CEO of BASF's corporation in the United States. So a great honor to have you here as well, Dr. Bock. Let me start out by asking both of you to give us a brief perspective on the carbon pricing scheme, both as just outlined and as you know it from past discussion. For many economists, of course, the attraction of this policy tool is that it's elegant and simple. It looks like a kind of a unified theory of energy transition. It appears to solve a lot of problems at one fell swoop. So my first question is, would you agree? Is this the policy tool, the primus inter pares among levers that could get us to a just energy transition? Laurence Tubiana.
Definitely, we need it. But the beauty, and I recognize in the initiative we have been presented, that now we are moving from a very theoretical, elegant type of economic theory, like an Econ 1 textbook, to something much more pragmatic, to really how we implement, how we put a value on a major external, global externality. And that's why it looks like certainly now much less elegant, much more practical, because we need to recognize that we will not have a global carbon price, at least for many years to come, and may not be the good solution. And that's why I really recognize the efforts of economists who step out their comfort zone to discuss with government, with business and others to say, we need really a practical instrument that put a value on this externality. It's not the only one. It will not solve everything, but we need it definitely.
Thank you very much. Dr. Bock?
Yeah, first, thanks for having me here. It's a real pleasure. When you run a company, you have less experience in these international kind of fora. And as head of this B20 task force, I was really a little bit skeptical. How do we do these things? Because you get so many people from different backgrounds talking about one topic, which is essentially climate change, and more specifically, what can companies do? As companies, we do like price signals, because that is really what markets are all about. And so in that context, as you said, this is a very, carbon pricing is a very elegant solution. However, as always, the devil is in the detail. And as soon as you drill down and then become a little bit more specific, how do we want to do this? You can clearly see that, yes, there might be very simple and very elegant solutions, but there can also be lots of escape routes if you really don't want to play ball. And that, I think, is really the core of the debate, how to create a level playing field using carbon pricing as an instrument.
So I want to come back to the level playing field, but perhaps one follow-up question to you, because many companies have started using carbon pricing internally, And maybe you can tell us what we can learn from that experience in the corporate world, and whether it necessarily follows on, if they're doing that, that they would then support rigorous carbon pricing schemes on a national, regional, or possibly someday even global level.
Yes, that's right. Many companies do it, including BASF. So we pressure test whether our investments are still valid and economical under certain assumptions with regard to the carbon price. Obviously, we don't take the current carbon price because that price in Europe, for instance, is, or in China, is relatively low. And that then also really leads to the core of the problem. There is such an uncertainty about what would be the right price for carbon that all these models currently are kind of helpful, again, in testing our assumptions, but do they really lead investment decisions globally? And there I'm a little bit skeptical right now, because for that you need simply a higher level of certainty that these carbon prices might really materialize. And then when they materialize, you have to think very hard about what might be side effects or collateral damage if this scenario really becomes reality. So it's complex. It's a little bit of guesswork at this point in time, because we really lack a more global and more certain pricing for carbon.
I'm hoping to get a bit of adversarial debate going, but certainly you do agree on the fact that the devil is in the details. So Laurence Tubiano, what would you say about where some of those details are? Where are the obstacles to making this thing work in practice?
There are problems of details, but there are problems of the political economy of that discussion as well. And I would be happy to discuss that with you, really taking that opportunity. On one side, we see progress where companies began to look at this and put this internal pricing, and I think that's a progress already, even if, of course, doesn't solve it all. On the second aspect, of course, many companies, and I can tell you, preparing Paris, that was a global call for many companies to have really a global carbon price, and if this global carbon price was not there, they could not move. And I think we need a little more sort of commitment here. I think that we need companies, everything is about expectation, as you mentioned, the clarity, the vision. Again, in Paris, we try to align expectations. But we need the companies to support the government when they decide for a carbon price. So clarity and certainty is a two-side thing. It's not only the government being clear, because they have to be supported to stick to their position and their policies. And I think too often we have a lot of conflicts, a lot of discussion that in a way blur the trend. So I think we need a clear joint commitment, and maybe that's where this B20 initiative would be so useful, that really we commit government and companies to stick to, if we take that trend, if we announce carbon pricing, if we see rising prices over time, then everyone stick to that commitment and support. If not, it's always too difficult to put in place this. So in this way, I think we need really a serious commitment from both sides.
What do you see in terms of the B20 network itself for consensus on this issue? Is there any, or are there a number of, let's say, laggards among your network?
I think there is kind of a consensus that carbon pricing is a very, very useful tool, and we should really get it more global. Yet individual countries, and that has been said before, most likely will then have specific variations of the theme, but we need really a global playing field here. This was a positive experience heading this task force, because these international, as you know this better than I do, these international kind of groups is like herding cats a little bit. And yet people moved from the very different countries, business people moved into the same direction and basically said, yes, that is what we need. Again, the problem is a little bit that it is relatively easy to make that kind of declaration. But then the question is, how do you follow through? How do you make sure that everybody plays by the same rules and you do not create a free rider problem? And that is really at the core of the issue, because if the system is not mandatory, then it is from a business point of view, individual company point of view, a relatively easy solution to be a free rider and apply a different set of standards than gaining access to markets, gaining market share, and ultimately making more money and don't really caring too much about the externalities which you create. So that is a little bit the problem here. It's, again, relatively easy to agree in principle, and then how do you really do it? And I fully agree with what Laurent said. We should have more commitment. And I think there is a core group of companies, a growing group of companies who feel that commitment and who are willing to live up to that commitment. Yet, we also have to be aware of this free rider issue.
No, certainly, but if we think, for example, where what happened in Sweden now years ago on the reform on the tax system, where you have a global commission at Swedish level that really discusses the different steps. I think we need that. In particular, in Europe, we need that. We need to agree on the floor price on carbon and probably on the perspective of it. And on the same in the same movement, we have to deal with the competitiveness issue you raised. But we have to be quite transparent about what really they are. And many times, the discussion goes in circles. And I would really call, and it would be such a beautiful signal from the European side, that if we agree on this, we will have a global discussion at European level that really allow to now really improve really the EU ETS market, to reach for a carbon price on other sectors where EU ETS doesn't apply, and then look in a very transparent way on the competitive issue and reach out to other countries like the B20 will do, where finally, if we compare to the 10 last years, in many, many countries, the carbon price has been there or is coming, both implicit or explicit carbon pricing. So I think that's a good moment to put the card on the table, in my view.
You can definitely speak to that, but were you suggesting in your last remarks that business only has that level playing field if there is a one single global carbon price, and that the map that we saw from Professor Edenhofer with lots of different national and regional systems simply doesn't deliver enough certainty and reliability for companies to view that as the famous level playing field?
In an ideal world, you would have one global price for carbon. How realistic is this? You can all think about this for a second and probably come to the conclusion that might be out there for another few decades. So what we need is an alignment between the regional and country systems, and hopefully an enforcement of those market rules which is comparable between the regions. So that is also very important. You can have carbon pricing, and then you have free allowances. And by having lots of free allowances, you can basically also allow companies to escape serious carbon pricing. That has been, by the way, a big discussion in Europe, as we all know, because people are concerned, I think rightfully, about carbon leakage. This becomes even more relevant when the system goes global. So again, the devil is in the detail, and it is very, very difficult to steer behavior into one direction if enforcement is not aligned. I think in that respect, the G20 meeting is a big opportunity to at least move into the right direction. I think that would be a first major step because, as said before, the G20 is responsible for about 80% of CO2 emissions. If I may add one other thought here, which was also discussed in our task force, which I think is probably equally important. This is not, from a business point of view, this is not just about carbon pricing. This is also about energy efficiency, and it's about innovation. And these are, let's say, natural interests of any company. We have to become more energy efficient as we speak, and I think all of us try to do this. And the higher the energy price, obviously, the more incentives you have to become more energy efficient. And we see innovation as really the solution to the problem. And I think it's not sufficient to talk about carbon pricing only, because you really have to speak then about the question or the issue: how do you become more energy efficient? How can you reduce the consumption of fossil-based raw materials and thereby reducing the carbon consumption. These are really core questions from business point of view, and there I think business can align relatively quickly. Yes, that is again a competitive issue, but it's also a big opportunity for companies.
Laurence de Vienne, we heard also from Mr. Lusch in the preceding discussion, no chance of a global carbon price in his view anytime soon. Certainly, if we look at developments in the US, we'd have to conclude that it's not likely to be moving in that direction anytime in the next 4, possibly 8 years. So would you agree global carbon price sounds good, but is highly unlikely?
Yes, it is evidently highly unlikely. That's why we didn't even try to put this in the Paris Agreement. But even more than that, when you look at the different levels of development and consider what a carbon price of, let's say, 30 or 50 euros a ton has an impact on the European economy, and the same level in Indian economy or in Chinese economy, that's pretty, the distributive aspect we didn't touch for the moment.
Just where I wanted to go.
Okay.
Thank you.
We have to consider that very seriously. So we should not aim at that in the near future because of the differences in the different economies. But I think we could do much better at European level. Again, if we take the history of European market, it was a really good lead, a transformation for the EU government to support that. I remember Kyoto Protocol and the opposition of the European ministers. I think we can do much better. This is really, for the moment, even if there are some good moods, still very disappointing. And I think, again, we can't just argue for a good carbon price and let the system in Europe so desperately bad. And it is bad. It is not enough. It doesn't deliver. I think we can think about a differentiation between carbon prices among countries. And again, look at the trade impacts. There are no mysteries there. We can measure for most of the products what is the impact of these different prices. And again, look at what happens in many countries. In China, there is already, not only because there is a carbon pricing system, but because there is energy taxes and others. So the level playing field is beginning certainly more even than before. And yes, we have to look at the trade discussion and have it beforehand anyway, which is probably the impact that the new US administration is putting the trade issue in front of our eyes. We have to discuss that. It would be very good to include climate in that discussion anyway. But as you said, there are social justice impacts that we have basically had a discussion between governments and companies about competitiveness and economic efficiency. And we just didn't have enough time to discuss what is the impact on the job destruction or job transformation, on the acquisitive power of people. And so that's why the public opinion, probably in most European countries and elsewhere, believes that it is only an additional cost to them and not something that could help in the distribution system.
But certainly we could, in theory, construct a carbon tax that it wouldn't necessarily have to be lower altogether for a lower income country, but it could include rebates for those who are hardest hit. It could include special mechanisms to help those workers who then are affected by the shift. There are plenty of secondary mechanisms we could put into place to balance out those distributive impacts, are there not?
You're totally right, absolutely. But the drama may be that it makes that society has to trust the government that this will happen. When I remember the discussion we had in France on the carbon tax, it failed just because of this. People, of course, supported in a way by the different lobbies, we didn't want the carbon tax, that's why I was calling for a compact behind this, behind the carbon floor price. The people didn't believe that finally they will receive that compensation. So they were distrusting the governments. So we need to recreate that trust. We can't have a tax reform policy. We can't have a carbon pricing. We can't have even a strong climate policy if we don't have trust between all the stakeholders. And that is an effort of everyone, by the way.
Staying on that point of the political economy of such schemes, Dr. Buck, we've heard this could generate the revenues that could be used for sustainable infrastructure, but would you trust governments to necessarily apply the revenues to that? Don't we know of cases in the past where revenues wind up getting channeled back into the general budget for use for all kinds of other things?
Yes, I think we have seen cases in the past where this has happened, actually. So there is a little bit of mistrust on our side that the system might be abused as a revenue generator. If it is a, let's say, not a side effect, but a positive effect of having a CO2 price scheme to really invest into infrastructure, I think this is good. This is really good. I think, however, we have to keep in mind the different stages of development of different countries. I mean, in Europe, we're facing different problems than in Africa. I came back from Beijing yesterday, and I tell you, they have not just a CO2 problem when you talk about the environmental situation. And we all know this. So how to make sure that, yes, we create more trust, but at the same time, we align growth and well-being of people and reducing CO2 emissions. I think business has come a long, long way accepting in today's world that this can be done in a positive way, meaning that this is not a contradiction, growth and CO2 reduction, but that can be done at the same time. And this is already a big, big step forward when you compare this to the discussion which we have had 10 or 15 years ago, where there was essentially neglect of that type of equation. Today we know we have only one planet and we have to do more with less. However, we do need growth, and I really want to make that point as well, because sometimes you hear that growth in itself is already bad for societies and for the world economy. You really have to think very hard whether you really want a society where you have no growth. I think it would be a disaster also from a society's distributional point of view. But we have to keep in mind, again, my point, the different stages of development of Europe, United States, some Asian economies, and many, many emerging economies and countries who are only starting to get serious about solving many of the environmental issues.
If I may come back to the dynamic of it, of course, it's important to know what we would do about the carbon revenue. I think it's very important as well to know where we are pointing to, and I would be happy to hear your views on that. Decarbonizing the economy is of course not only to have a price, but to know where we should be if we want to be compatible with Paris Agreement, well below 2°C. Otmar has set the big carbon budget, but now it has to translate in every country carbon budget, in every company, particularly the global company carbon budget. How we know where we should be, or what does it take to be compatible with this decarbonization future, and what are the different steps the different companies, the different cities, the different regions, and the different governments should take? I think we had to know that. Why I'm saying that? Because we need not only to fund what is obvious and evident, the compensation and the investment, but we have to fund innovation. And you, in your company, which you use a lot of energy, and how you will see your future as a net zero emission by 2050 is an element of information so important, even for government to be sure that they are not de-industrializing their country, in particular your country in Germany, but they can trust that there is a solution out there. And we lack that discussion because we are just talking about incremental progress and not deep transformation progress. And I would like to couple this discussion of the pricing the externality with a vision of the decarbonization that everyone has to clarify and implement.
Thank you very much. That takes us back actually to the keynote that we heard this morning. I don't know if you both were there already when we heard Bertrand Piccard speak about, you know, we hear it all the time, but paradigm change, paradigm shift. And he gave some very wonderful examples of such paradigm shifts that are really, as we know, a complete transformation of the way that we think about something. Would you say your company has a vision like that?
We certainly have a vision to reduce CO2 emissions further on, and actually trust you only create if you also provide transparency. I think this is the starting point of every discussion. And my company, BASF, for instance, we for years have published not just our CO2 emission reduction targets, but also our performance. We also explain, which I think is very important, how our products help to reduce CO2 emissions. Actually, we can demonstrate that chemical industry, including BASF, has a positive CO2 balance, meaning our products used across their life cycle reduce more CO2, much more CO2 than what is needed to produce a product. It's very interesting for the chemical industry. The debate is really one of speed. I think I have to make that point here, because very often we can agree on the long-term targets. The question is just, how do you get there? And the political debate is a little bit one-sided, I think, because we have these very visionary targets, 2050 or even 2100, when we are completely decarbonized, apparently. And we have to develop technologies and innovations how to get there. And we see what we can do, and you might say you can do better, and you have to challenge yourself much more in order to push the boundaries. Yet I think we also have to be realistic about what can be done and how fast. And that, I think, will be the discussion, both in developed countries and in emerging countries at the end of the day. It's not the question of, do we want this? Do we want to go there? It's really the question, how and how fast? And then it becomes really nitty-gritty detail, but I think that debate is unavoidable.
We have a how debate coming up, so I'm actually going to ask our Twitter expert, Paul Christian Britz, to come back here and give us what you might have in the way of comments, questions, and or that vote on the carbon price, and then we'll get a last comment from our two green sofa sitters.
So yes, I want to start with an intermediate result of the vote. It's been actually very interesting to watch, and maybe, just maybe, I can get an answer from the two of you to that question of what should the price of carbon be? Maybe you want to pick a country, maybe you want to pick a place. What do you
or
think?
Or a company, since BASF is working with its own carbon price. What is it? Will you share that with us?
I don't think we share this with each and everybody. Nope.
Okay. I won't claim that we're off the record.
Some of your colleagues do, huh? So you could think about that.
Then you get to pick anyway, Dr. Buck, which of these different, but try not to look at the at the answers of the audience. Our choices were
$5, $20, $50, or $100 or more.
Which one do you like the best?
Five is too low, 100 would kill us instantly and definitely. So it has to be somewhere in the middle. At the end of the day, it has to be a market-driven price. That is, again, it's very, very important. The mindset is a little bit right now, make it a political price. The starting point of the debate was this should be a price set by the market to achieve a given target, reduce emissions by X percent at the lowest possible cost. That was the starting point of the European ETS.
And so, Madame Tubiana, your vote, I'm not, perhaps you want to give us a few different variants, but...
The problem is by when, no? The 50 is already, I think, in the European situation is certainly a sort of a good base. But by when? The question is by when it happens. And I think that's interesting because the trend is we should be at 100 by 2020 or 2023, but we should go up now from now. And so I think the where we are now is, of course, as we agree on that, insignificant. And then we have, of course, to set up at least 250. But I don't know what the poll
tell
was.
What did the audience say?
So the audience, it was actually interesting to watch. We started at $100 and more with a majority of nearly 80%. And then as the discussion continued, we're now seeing 41% on $100 and more, or 41% at 50. There's a little bit of an edge to 5 over 20, but that doesn't seem to be a very popular part. Now, as been pointed out in the discussion, of course, it would depend on various countries. Maybe the price might differ in various countries. So there's one suggestion here. 1,000 units of local currency per kilogram of CO2 would be a good price, depending on the value of the currency, therefore, about 100 or more. Maybe that explains the high number. And then there's one particular tweet that I'd like to highlight. I hope you can see this, saying, this is the price of carbon And then posting a video that shows hailstorms in Spain this weekend. Flooding streets. I hope you can see this video playing right now. That is the price of carbon right now. That's a statement. And that's it for now, I'd say.
Thank you very much.
Come back to that later, maybe, and see how that vote changes.
We'll be watching those returns. You can still vote on that carbon price if you like, ladies and gentlemen. At any rate, you did not decide to take Lisa Davis's carbon price. She was the CEO of Siemens Energy. She put her mark on 25, but clearly our audience thinks that is too low. So many thanks to both of you for being with us here for the Green Sofa debate. It's been a pleasure. Thank you. You may.